to Moments Orthodox Presbyterian Church for our evening service in the name of our Lord and Savior. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of the living God with silent prayer. Stand for our call to worship from Psalm 107. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be in our midst this evening. Please turn in the Psalter hymnal to number 106b. Oh, praise the Lord, for he is good. We'll sing verses 8 through 14 of number 106b. Providential that this is the question and answer, because repentance is going to form a very large part of what we're looking at in Samuel tonight. And so the repentance unto life has these elements in it. The person repenting hates their sin, and that is enough of a hatred that the person turns away from it and turns to God. So let us confess our faith together with these words. What is repentance unto life? Repentance unto life is a saving grace wrought in the heart of a sinner by the Spirit and Word of God, whereby, out of the sense and sense not only of the danger, but also of the filthiness and odiousness of his sins, and upon the apprehension of God's mercy in Christ to such as are penitent, he so grieves for and hates his sins, as that he turns from them all to God, purposing and endeavoring constantly to walk with him in all the ways of new obedience. Of Jerusalem is going to be as if you took a videotape of the creation and played it backwards. The people are gone, the trees are gone. It goes back to the Hebrew phrase tohu vavohu, which is without form and void, as it says in verse 23. And so the people of God are the creation. In this sort of microcosmic way, they represent all of creation, and they're being decreated, and that is an exceptionally painful thing for Jeremiah to watch. And so he calls to them to repent truly. This is the word of our God, Jeremiah 4. If you return, O Israel, declares the Lord, to me you should return. If you remove your detestable things from my presence and do not waver, and if you swear as the Lord lives, in truth, in justice, and in righteousness, then nations shall bless themselves in him, and in him shall they glory. For thus says the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground, and sow not among thorns. Circumcise yourselves to the Lord, remove the foreskin of your hearts, O men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my wrath go forth like fire and burn with none to quench it because of the evil of your deeds. Declare in Judah and proclaim in Jerusalem and say, blow the trumpet through the land, cry aloud and say, assemble and let us go into the fortified cities. Raise a standard toward Zion, flee for safety, stay not, for I bring disaster from the north and great destruction. A lion has gone up from his thicket. A destroyer of nations has set out. He has gone out from his place to make your land a waste. Your cities will be ruins without inhabitant. For this, put on sackcloth, lament and wail. For the fierce anger of the Lord has not turned back from us. In that day, declares the Lord, courage shall fail both king and officials. The priests shall be appalled, and the prophets astounded. Then I said, ah, Lord God, surely you have utterly deceived this people in Jerusalem, saying, it shall be well with you, whereas the sword has reached their very life. At that time it will be said to this people and to Jerusalem, a hot wind from the bare heights in the desert toward the daughter of my people, not to winnow or cleanse. A wind too full for this comes for me. Now it is I who speak in judgment upon them. Behold, he comes up like clouds, his chariots like the whirlwind. His horses are swifter than eagles. Woe to us, for we are ruined. O Jerusalem, wash your heart from evil, that you may be saved. How long shall your wicked thoughts lodge within you? For a voice declares from Dan and proclaims trouble from Mount Ephraim. Warn the nations that he is coming. Announce to Jerusalem, besiegers come from a distant land. They shout against the cities of Judah. Like keepers of a field are they against her all around, because she has rebelled against me, declares the Lord. Your ways and your deeds have brought this upon you. This is your doom, and it is bitter. It has reached your very heart. My anguish, I writhe in pain. Oh, the walls of my heart. My heart is beating wildly. I cannot keep silent, for I hear the sound of the trumpet, the alarm of war. Crash follows hard on crash. The whole land is laid waste. Suddenly my tents are laid waste, my curtains in a moment. How long must I see the standard and hear the sound of the trumpet? For my people are foolish, they know me not. They are stupid children, they have no understanding. They are wise in doing evil, but how to do good, they know not. I looked on the earth, and behold, it was without form and void, and to the heavens, and they had no light. I looked on the mountains, and behold, they were quaking, and all the hills moved to and fro. I looked, and behold, there was no man, and all the birds of the air had fled. I looked, and behold, the fruitful land was a desert, and all its cities were laid in ruins before the Lord, before his fierce anger. For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be a desolation, yet I will not make a full end. For this the earth shall mourn, and the heavens above be dark. For I have spoken, I have purposed, I have not relented, nor will I turn back. At the noise of horsemen and archer, every city takes to flight. They enter thickets, they climb among rocks. All the cities are forsaken, and no man dwells in them. And you, O desolate one, what do you mean that you dress in scarlet, that you adorn yourselves with ornaments of gold, that you enlarge your eyes with paint? In vain you beautify yourself. Your lovers despise you. They seek your life. For I heard a cry, as of a woman in labor, anguish as of one giving birth to her first child, the cry of the daughter of Zion, gasping for breath, stretching out her hands, woe is me, I am fainting before murderers. Let us come before the Lord our God in prayer. O Lord God, our heavenly Father, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you have all wisdom and knowledge, and the fear of you is the beginning of wisdom for us. We ask, Father, for wisdom to be given, and for us to grow in it, even as it is a fountain of life for us. Lord, we praise you that you have revealed yourself to your people, and you have given us the path of life. You have given us all the words of instruction that we need in your scriptures. We ask, Father, for an undivided heart, that we would not have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom, but that we would have both feet in your kingdom. We ask, Father, for you to give us the proper reverent awe and fear of your name, that before you we are nothing. Give us grace then also to love you with our heart, soul, strength, and mind. We know, Father, that you have set your love on us first, and that's what enables us to love you. We ask, Father, for you to circumcise our hearts to love you with all of who we are, and that there would be no veil between us and the truth, but that we would see your truth revealed to us and love your truth. We know, Father, we do not now see you, but we desire to believe. Help our unbelief. We ask, Father, for Christ's love to constrain us so that we live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again on our behalf. Help us not to love the things of the world. Help us instead to love what is above, to love what you love and hate what you hate. Help us to hate our sin with an everlasting enmity. Help us to turn from it in revulsion and turn to you, the author and finisher of our faith. We pray, Father, that we would hate sin for its own sake, and that we would not secretly rejoice in sin, but that we would turn in repentance from it. Take the stony parts of our heart out and give us hearts of flesh. Keep us from all kinds of evil. Keep us, Father, from being duped by Satan and his temptations, but also keep us from depending and consulting our own sinful hearts as if they were not deceitful. Help us instead, Father, to lean on your understanding and your word, to trust in you and not lean on our own understanding. We pray, Father, that you would take away all our pride and ego. We pray, Father, that you would help us instead to be humble before you, to be your humble servants, to serve you and to serve one another with a joyful and rejoicing heart. We pray, Father, you would forgive us our sins because of Jesus and what he has done. And we pray, Father, you would give us repentance unto life and that continual newness of relationship with you, that we would continually be brought back to the goodness of the gospel. Forgive us, Father, for ever thinking that we could outgrow the gospel. But teach us instead the deeper things, so that we will rejoice in you always. We pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please turn with me to hymn number 485. O Thou that hearest when sinners cry, we'll stand and sing 485.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord our God, you are very great. And Father, you have revealed your greatness to us, your saving grace, what we need for the Christian walk. And we ask, Father, for your help in understanding it and living it out and rejoicing in your truth. We pray your Holy Spirit will guide us to our Savior Jesus in these pages. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to turn the scriptures to 1 Samuel chapter 26. This is page 294 in the Church Bible. 1 Samuel chapter 26. Hear now God's holy, inspired, and inerrant. Then the Ziphites came to Saul at Gibeah, saying, "Is not David hiding himself on the hill of Hakilah, which is on the east of Jeshimon?" So Saul arose and went down to the wilderness of Ziph with 3,000 chosen men of Israel to seek David in the wilderness of Ziph. Saul encamped on the hill of Hakilah, which is beside the road on the east of Jeshimon. But David remained in the wilderness. When he saw that Saul came after him into the wilderness, David sent out spies and learned that Saul had indeed come. Then David rose and came to the place where Saul had encamped. David saw the place where Saul lay with Abner, the son of Ner, the commander of his army. Saul was lying within the encampment, while the army was encamped around him. Then David said to Ahimelech the Hittite and to Joab's brother Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, "Who will go down with me into the camp to Saul?" And Abishai said, "I will go down with you." So David and Abishai went to the army by night. But there lay Saul sleeping within the encampment with his spear stuck in the ground at his head, and Abner and the army lay around him. Then Abishai said to David, "God has given your enemy into your hand this day. Now please let me pin him to the earth with one stroke of the spear, and I will not strike him twice." But David said to Abishai, "Do not destroy him. For who can put out his hand against the Lord's anointed and be guiltless?" And David says, "The Lord lives, the Lord will strike him, or his day will come to die, or he will go down into battle and perish. The Lord forbid that I should put out my hand against the Lord's anointed. But take now the spear that is at his head and the jar of water and let us go." So David took the spear and the jar of water from Saul's head and they went away. No man saw it or knew it. Nor did any awake, for they were all asleep, because a deep sleep from the Lord had fallen upon them. Then David went over to the other side and stood far off on the top of the hill with a great space between them. David called to the army and to Abner the son of Ner, saying, "Will you not answer, Abner?" Then Abner answered, "Who are you who calls to the king?" David said to Abner, "Are you not a man? Who is like you in Israel? Why then have you not kept watch over your lord the king? For one of the people came in to destroy the king your lord. This thing that you have done is not good. As the Lord lives, you deserve to die because you have not kept watch over your lord, the Lord's anointed. And now see where the king's spear is and the jar of water that was at his head." Saul recognized David's voice and said, "Is this your voice, my son David?" David said, "It is my voice, my lord, O king." And he said, "Why does my lord pursue after his servant? For what have I done? What evil is on my hands? Now therefore, let my lord the king hear the words of his servant. If it is the Lord who has stirred you up against me, may he accept an offering. But if it is men, may they be cursed before the Lord. For they have driven me out this day that I should have no share in the heritage of the Lord, saying, 'Go, serve other gods.' Now therefore, let not my blood fall to the earth, away from the presence of the Lord. For the king of Israel has come out to seek a single flea, like one who hunts a partridge in the mountains." Then Saul said, "I have sinned. Return, my son David, for I will no more do you harm, because my life was precious in your eyes this day. Behold, I have acted foolishly, and have made a great mistake." And David answered and said, "Here is the spear, O king. Let one of the young men come over and take it. The Lord rewards every man for his righteousness and his faithfulness. For the Lord gave you into my hand today, and I would not put out my hand against the Lord's anointed. Behold, as your life was precious this day in my sight, so may my life be precious in the sight of the Lord, and may he deliver me out of all tribulation. Then Saul said to David, Blessed be you, my son David. You will do many things and will succeed in them. So David went his way, and Saul returned to his place. If this chapter feels a little bit like deja vu, that's because it bears a very strong resemblance to the first time David spared Saul's life, and that's just two chapters ago, in chapter 24. In both instances, Saul's hunting David. In both chapters, it's the Ziphites who betray David to Saul. In both instances, Saul becomes vulnerable somehow. And in both instances, at least one of David's men interprets that vulnerability as a God-given opportunity to kill Saul. And in both instances, David refuses to capitalize on Saul's vulnerability and instead rebukes his men for wanting Saul's blood. In both instances, Saul and David have a conversation where David shows Saul how much he had Saul in his power but still spared him. And in both instances, Saul sees that David's in the right. Now, liberal scholars look at these similarities and conclude that they are two tellings of the same incident. However, the differences between the two accounts are just as important as the similarities, and show us that the two chapters actually describe two distinct events. So in our chapter here at 26, David actually goes down to Saul's camp, whereas in chapter 24, it's Saul going into a cave where David is. And that points to another difference connected to that one, namely that in this chapter, David's more of the hunter, whereas in chapter 24, it was Saul who was hunting David. In chapter 26, David takes the spear and the water jug, whereas in chapter 24, it was a corner of Saul's robe. In this chapter, God uses a deep sleep. By the way, this is the same kind of sleep that God put Adam into when he took the rib out of him and made a woman out of that rib. And it's also the same kind of sleep that he put Abram in during the confirmation of the covenant. In chapter 24, though, God used Saul's waste removal system as the providential incident. Here, in chapter 26, David actually goes down into the camp, whereas in 24, Saul comes to David, even if unwittingly. This time, in 26, Saul actually admits that he sinned, whereas in chapter 24, he only admits that David is more righteous than he. So while we will look at the chapter as a whole, it is more important to look at the differences so that we can ask and answer this question. What more does this chapter teach us than chapter 24 did? Well, we also have to keep in mind the chapter that's in between, chapter 25. And the first thing we learn then is what a difference Abigail made. You see, without Abigail's intervention in chapter 25, David's patience might very well have run out. And Abigail's wonderful speech convinced David that even if he was dealing with a fool in Nabal, it was important not to overreact. And that was with somebody who wasn't even the Lord's anointed for anything. But even with somebody who was not the Lord's anointed, David had to be careful. This makes David even more careful than when a second opportunity arises to get rid of his rival. And David, he might have attempted to think that he was justified in thinking that if Saul was going to continue to sin against him anyway, then David's responsibility is to lash out. But after Abigail, David no longer thinks that way. He understands completely now it's the Lord's job to exact vengeance and make everything right. Now, Abishai is the one to propose the vengeance that would be so carnally sweet. He makes the punishment fit the crime. The spear that Abishai mentions is probably a reference to Saul's own spear, not a spear that Abishai had of his own. He would take Saul's spear, the instrument that Saul had been using to try to kill David, and he would kill Saul with that very same instrument. Doesn't that sound poetic justice? He knows he wouldn't have to keep on trying to kill Saul. The statement, "Oh, I wouldn't have to strike twice," is probably a reference to the fact that Saul was unable to pin David to the wall twice when he tried. Abishai is seeking to make this very much a tit-for-tat kind of situation. But David rejects Abishai's plan of action. But he does do something symbolic. He proposes, and they accomplish, this theft of Saul's spear. Saul's spear, of course, represents Saul's power, particularly his military power. And David's taking that away. Of course, David's already much more effective in fighting off Israel's enemies than Saul ever thought of being. So this is a sort of taking of that symbolic military power to himself. And most scholars also agree that in the taking of the jar of water, David was symbolically taking away Saul's life without actually doing it. Water was life in the ancient Near East, after all. David wishes to send a very clear message to Saul. Both his life and his power are in David's hands. And David let him go. David is also telling Saul in this that God's going to be the one who ends Saul's life. It won't be David. And the way David tells Saul this is through his rebuke of Abner, kind of indirect, if you will. The rebuke is somewhat playful on David's part. "You're the great key man of Israel, Abner. What you doing falling down on the job like that?" But it's got a little bit of a bite in it, too. Because David is, in essence, saying that he would be a much better helper to Saul than your pitiful Abner would be. David was keeping watch when Abner was in a deep sleep. Of course, it was really the Lord who put all of Saul's camp into this deep sleep, but David embarrasses Abner so much that Abner doesn't have a thing to say. One assumes that David held up the spear in the water jug during that last sentence. "Now look at where the king's spear is and the jar of water that was at his head. Where is it?" And Saul, of course, is the one who responds. His first response is the same as his response in chapter 24. "Was that David or not? Is that your voice, my son, David?" Again, emphasizing the relationship, which somehow has been reinstated. David immediately launches into his defense of himself. His main problem is that the human beings who are stirring up Saul against David are forcing David into violations of the first commandment. They are, in effect, telling David to go worship other gods by saying, "David's not welcome in Israel." David doesn't think he's worth all that trouble and bother. Calls himself a flea. Like someone hunting a partridge. I'm just a little bird. What are you after me for? You pursue me, but you don't hunt Israel's enemies. That comparison to a single flea, he said the same thing in chapter 24. It's just as silly this time as it was that time. Now, there is a difference here in Saul's response, and even though it's a little bit better this time, we can still see that he does not truly repent. And it's remarkable, really, because if you look at it, you don't read it, you read it kind of fast, and it looks like real repentance. But several things would be different in his response if he was truly repentant. If he had been truly repentant, he would have turned to God for forgiveness. And secondly, as Richard Phillips notes, a repentant Saul would also have asked David to keep the spear or destroy it. Why? Because that would have been the clinching argument that he was never going to pursue David any further. He would be getting rid of the source of the temptation, as it were. But like I said, it could be easy to mistake Saul's words here for genuine repentance, and to his credit, he actually takes responsibility for having sinned this time. But here we learn there's a difference between even confession of sin and repentance. It could look like repentance even more because of his promise not to hunt David anymore, which might seem like he did a 180. But David doesn't believe it, as you'll see in the next chapter. And Saul does not, in fact, even get a chance to hunt down David anymore. So we'll actually never know in this life whether he would have broken his promise or not. But we can still say this is not true repentance. If we look further ahead in redemptive history, there's a rich tradition of what David does here, and it's magnified later on. When Jesus is on the cross, he has the power to eliminate all the powers of hell right then and there. He could call on his Father. His Father could send a myriad of angels to save him and strike down those who had put him on the cross. He could eliminate all the Romans, all the Jews, not to mention Satan and his legions of demons, but then how would salvation have been accomplished? All righteousness would not be fulfilled if Jesus did that. We wouldn't have salvation if Jesus had done it that way. There would be no substitute for us. Jesus leaves vengeance on the righteous judgment to his Father, and his Father answers it with resurrection from the dead. This conquers the powers of darkness, completes the salvation of God's people, and vindicates the righteousness of God, Father and Son. So how do we apply these words to our lives? Well, the first application has to do with the ability to do something. And just because we can do something doesn't mean we should. As we can see, David had the power to execute Saul. A lot of people would say that he was justified in doing so. He could have caved into the pressure that Abishai was putting on him, couldn't he? But he didn't do that. A negative example of this sort of reminds me of the cartoon. The man is at the keyboard typing, and his wife says to him, "Honey, don't you want to go to sleep?" And he says, "I can't. Someone on the internet is wrong." Just because you could answer everybody doesn't mean that's a good idea. People rarely get convinced of anything during internet debates anyway. They're not typically very profitable. People say all sorts of things they would never say if that person was standing right there in front of them. It's rarely anything other than an opportunity for people to exercise their outrage at stuff that's going on. And I'm sure we can think of a lot of other situations where we have the ability to do something, and there might even be some elements in the situation that would seem to justify us doing that sort of thing, but it still may not be the right thing to do. It still may be us taking too much on ourselves. And just because it may feel good to contemplate, that doesn't make it right either. How good would it have felt to David to finally bring his enemy to heel? But he lets God do that. Secondly, it's very easy to make a mistake about what true repentance is and what it is not. Saul sounds so very genuine here, doesn't he? But true repentance is, as we saw in the larger catechism there, it involves hatred of the sin. And it also involves preventive maintenance, if you will, getting rid of the source of temptation so it won't happen again. In Saul's case, it would have been getting rid of the spear, the thing he'd been using to go after David. So if something is an occasion for sin, we need to get rid of it. For some people, it's the internet. As helpful and amazing as the internet is for so many things, it's also a very dangerous place. And while there are safeguards that can be put into place, and some of them are very effective, if that's not sufficient, it's better not to have the internet than to be constantly tempted to misuse it. There are things that people can get addicted to, especially young people. They can get addicted to smartphones. We decided in our family our children would not have smartphones while they're still living in our house. They have emergency flip phones or dumb phones for when they travel. For others, it's food or drink that's where the problem lies. As with many of these things, there are good things that can be misused, and there are bad things that are inherently bad. The inherent use of something like internet, food, drink, that's not the evil, is it? It's whether that turns into an abuse of the thing that is the problem. Using the internet for evil purposes, eating too much food, drinking too much alcohol, these are the things where the moderate use is good, the immoderate use is bad. The last point is, we need real repentance all the time. All the time. It reminds me of what one pastor used to ask of every candidate who came into the presbytery in Siouxlands Presbytery. This was my first call. His question, he always asked every candidate this: when was the last time you sinned? And of course, the correct answer was, I'm sinning all the time. And that constant sin needs constant repentance. It's almost like it's a fundamental attitude that we have towards God, towards our Lord Jesus. Fundamentally, always acknowledging our sin. Always saying, Lord, I hate it. Turn me away from it. David understood this concept very well. And that's the reason why David is forgiven, even in the face of his own actions consisting of murder and adultery. But Saul is not forgiven because he doesn't truly repent. That's the difference. That's something we meditate on. What's the difference between true and false repentance? May we be a congregation of repenters. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word and for its clarity, and we pray, Father, that you will work in our hearts to desire this true repentance and to turn in hatred of our sin towards you. Help us, Father, to get rid of the sources of temptation in our lives, and help us, Father, to truly repent and turn to you always. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We need help. We need to turn to our Jesus and remember again what he suffered. So let us turn to hymn number 248. Ah, Holy Jesus, how hast thou offended? We'll stand and sing 248.
Thank you.
Please stand for God's blessing and benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.